There were hundreds of Muslim prisoners being held in Guantanamo Bay. But that also, we had in Guantanamo Bay our U.S. Army Muslim chaplain. And that, perhaps, would be an indication to the world, to the international community, that the United States was treating these prisoners in Guantanamo Bay humanely. I was disturbed by these many, many things that was going on. I was disturbed how prisoners were being held in cage-like cells, being treated more like animals.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. On behalf of the Islamic Research Foundation, we begin this afternoon's formal public talks program. We start with Guantanamo Bay arouses curiosity and mystery in the minds of many. Our speaker, Brother James Yusuf Yee, has been on both sides of this war on terror fence, a unique personality indeed. He was commissioned as the first Muslim chaplain in the United States Army, in fact, one of the first. After the tragic attacks of September 11, 2001, he became a frequent government spokesman, helping to educate soldiers about Islam and building understanding throughout the military. Subsequently, Captain Yee was selected to serve as the Muslim chaplain for the prison camp at Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. That would become controversial for its treatment of detainees designated as enemy combatants by the US government, where nearly 700 detainees captured in the war on terror were being held as unlawful combatants. While ministering or talking to these prisoners at Guantanamo Bay, Captain Yee advised camp commanders on detainee religious practices and objected to the cruel and degrading abuses to which the prisoners were subjected. In September 2003, after serving at Guantanamo for 10 months in a role that gave him unrestricted access to the detainees, and after receiving numerous awards for the services there, Chaplain Yee was secretly arrested. That too on his way to meet his wife and daughter for a routine two-week leave. He was locked away in a Navy prison, subjected to much of the same treatment that had been imposed on the Guantanamo detainees, wrongfully accused of spying, espionage, and aiding the alleged Taliban and Al-Qaeda prisoners. Yee spent 76 excruciating days in a Navy brig, that's a prison, in 2003 in solitary confinement. And he was subjected to sensory deprivation techniques that were being used against Guantanamo prisoners and those declared as enemy combatants. He was also threatened with the death penalty after the US government determined that it had made a great mistake in its original allegations. It vindictively charged him with adultery and computer pornography. But in the end, all criminal charges were dropped and Captain Yee's record wiped clean. He was reinstated to full duty at Fort Lewis, Washington. But his reputation was tarnished, and what had been a promising military career was left in ruins. He tendered his resignation from the U.S. Army and received an honorable discharge on January 7, 2005. Upon separation, he was awarded with a second Army Commendation Medal for exceptionally meritorious service. Chaplain Yee's gripping account in his book entitled For God and Country, Faith and Patriotism Under Fire is a remarkable reading. And it poses a fundamental question. If our country cannot be loyal to even the most patriotic Americans, can it remain loyal to itself? The Washington Post called it required reading for all U.S. officials waging war on Islamic terrorists. For this work, Yee received the Exceptional Communicator Award from New America Media in January 2006. Chaplain James Yusuf Yee is a third-generation Chinese-American, and in 1990, he graduated from West Point and then reverted to Islam in April 1991. He served in the U.S. Army for 14 years and has been to the Middle East in Saudi Arabia and other places where he has learned his Islamic academic studies and training. In June 2006, Captain Yee earned his master's degree in international relations. He now lectures about his harrowing ordeals, Guantanamo Bay, Islam, Asian Americans, and religious diversity issues, and the challenges of protecting both national security and civil liberties. He has appeared on national and global news programs, including the famous O'Reilly Factor, MSNBC's Hardball, Situation Room with Wolf Blitzer, PBS Religion and Ethics, Al Jazeera's From Washington, Democracy Now!, NPR All Things Considered, MSNBC's The Situation with Tucker Carlson, CSPN2 Afterwards, ABC Australia's The 7:30 Report, US Sky World News Tonight, and BBC World Service. Chaplain Yee has briefed congressional staff members of USA on Capitol Hill and lectured at Harvard, Yale, Oxford, UK, Columbia, Stanford, Duke, Northwestern University, and several other academic institutions of higher learning in the US and the UK. An apt and very experienced speaker to speak on the topic of the day, Guantanamo Bay, abuse of human rights and justice. Brothers and sisters, let's welcome Brother James Yusuf Yee.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahabi ajma'in. All praise is due to Allah. And may the peace and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon our last Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his righteous family, his noble companions, and also upon all of those who follow the path of truth. And God willing, inshallah, that is all of us who are here today. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's really my great distinct pleasure and honor to be here today to talk to you about this issue of Guantanamo and the struggle for justice and human rights that goes on there. I'm inspired always by telling others about my experience, my story, of what it was like for me as a U.S. Army Muslim chaplain to serve in this now notorious prison camp. And I hope that my presentation today is one that inspires all of you to do what you can to stand up for justice and human rights. Let me begin by telling you a little bit more of my background. You heard much of it in the introduction. I'm a third generation Chinese American, meaning it was my grandparents who came to the United States. Both of my parents were born in America, as well as myself and all of my brothers and sisters, my two older sisters and my two younger brothers. You heard I was a former military officer and chaplain, graduating from the prestigious West Point, the United States Military Academy. But not only am I a graduate of the military academy, and a former U.S. military member, but the military is actually rooted in my family. My younger brother is also a West Point graduate. And my other younger brother serves today on active duty as an Army doctor. My one brother, who is a West Point graduate, as we speak right now, serves with the U.S. military in Iraq. My father also served in the U.S. military. He was drafted during World War II. So the military culture is rooted in my family. And having served in the military, I can say that it's been an experience that I'm proud of with regard to the contributions that myself and other family members had made towards what's known as national security. But not only am I former military, you heard in the introduction that I am a Muslim convert. I converted to Islam in 1991, shortly after I graduated West Point. My journey to Islam, in and of itself, is an inspiring story. one that I hope to share with all of you in another setting, in another presentation. But yes, I converted to Islam, and being a Muslim is an essential part of my life's experience, because ultimately I would then go and achieve the goal of becoming a Muslim chaplain. I was one of the first chaplains to serve within the ranks of the United States military. And let me tell you a little bit about chaplaincy in the military. What is chaplaincy? The role of the chaplain in the U.S. military is to defend religious freedom, to defend the rights of religious freedom for all those who serve in the military. But not only do we chaplains defend those religious rights of those soldiers serving, but we also defend the religious rights of those civilian employees who may be working on military installations, and also to those prisoners who may be incarcerated or imprisoned by the U.S. military. One of the things that I saw and recognized first and foremost in my assignment to Guantanamo was that role to defend religious freedom. I became a Muslim chaplain in January of 2001 after having converted to Islam, learning a little more in depth about the faith, even studying a little bit of the Arabic language to be able to recite the Holy Quran in its classical form. I then returned to the U.S. Armed Forces as a Muslim chaplain in 2001, January. 2001, the world knows what happened in that year, in September. September 11, 2001, the tragic attacks on the World Trade Center and on the U.S. Pentagon happened on September 11th. At that particular time, I was a Muslim chaplain serving in the U.S. Armed Forces. It was almost immediately following these attacks that I was approached by senior level leaders, and they would ask me if I would begin training, teaching Islam and the Muslim culture to the soldiers who were serving within the ranks. I would hold lessons, briefings, lectures about Islam, educating those troops. I would begin to receive praise and recognition as someone who was building bridges of understanding, helping these young men and women become better soldiers. I look back on that experience now and speculate that I was asked to do this job because senior level leaders in the military knew following 9/11 that soldiers of the U.S. military were going to be deployed, sent to Muslim nations, Muslim countries like Afghanistan, like Iraq, and like the many other Muslim nations where you find U.S. troops deployed to today. But nevertheless, in carrying out this duty, I educated troops about Islam and the faith that I converted to. That praise and recognition came from the highest levels in the Pentagon, in the State Department, and I believe it was that praise and recognition that I received in the immediate post 9/11 aftermath that landed me the assignment in Guantanamo Bay, the prison camp where hundreds of prisoners have been held in this so-called war on terror. In fact, every prisoner that has been held in Guantanamo has been a Muslim. Every prisoner that has been held by the U.S. military in Guantanamo has been Muslim. And when I was sent there in November of 2002, there were some 660 or so prisoners, all of them Muslim. I look back at that assignment when I was given the orders to go to Guantanamo Bay. I speculated then as well that perhaps I was being sent as a Muslim chaplain to Guantanamo Bay so that my government, so that my nation could say to the world that yes, indeed, there were hundreds of Muslim prisoners being held in Guantanamo Bay, but that also we had in Guantanamo Bay our U.S. Army Muslim chaplain. And that, perhaps, would be an indication to the world, to the international community, that the United States was treating these prisoners in Guantanamo Bay humanely, that the United States was being sensitive to the religion, to the faith of these prisoners, which was Islam, which is Islam. I thought perhaps that was the reason behind me being sent to Guantanamo. Well, when I got down to Guantanamo as the Muslim chaplain, I learned that I did have two roles to play. One role was to be an advisor to the camp commander on how religion affected this military detention operation, how the religious practices of these prisoners, these Muslim prisoners, affected the detention operation. That was my first role as an advisor. The second role that I had was to be a chaplain to all of the Muslims in Guantanamo, not only the 660 or so Muslim prisoners, but I was also a chaplain to the many American Muslims down in Guantanamo. Yes, there are also American Muslims in Guantanamo, but not as prisoners. There are many American Muslims who work down in Guantanamo, serving mostly as translators. Translators. Imagine, at that time, 660 or so Muslim prisoners being held in Guantanamo. How many languages do you think were spoken in this prison camp? Many languages, from Arabic to Pashto, Farsi, Urdu, Turkish, Chinese. European languages included German, French, Russian. Who handled the linguistic needs of this military prison operation? Translators, American translators, most of whom were American Muslims. I was a chaplain to the American Muslims, as well as a chaplain to the Muslim prisoners. But in my role as a chaplain to the Muslim prisoners, I was given authorized, unescorted access into the prison cell blocks. I was one of the very few individuals who was allowed to speak openly and freely with the Muslim prisoners. And in that dialogue, in that conversation, in that personal interaction with these prisoners in Guantanamo, I learned a lot of what was really going on inside this prison camp. Not only inside the prison cell blocks, but also inside the interrogation rooms. In Guantanamo, there are two operations. There's a detention operation where the prisoners are being held in the cell blocks. Back then, they were being held in what was like caged-like cells. That part of the operation was ran by guards, military police, who handled the everyday needs of the prisoners, like bringing the prisoners their food, their change of clothes, escorting prisoners to recreation, those types of things. That's one side of the operation. The other side of the operation is the intelligence gathering operation, where interrogators and military intelligence officers interrogate the prisoners to try and extract information from them. Well, I learned of the abuses that was going on in the cell blocks and in the interrogation rooms, not only from the prisoners directly themselves, but also from many of the American translators who worked in these intelligence and guard operations and had much information about those transgressions. As a U.S. Army chaplain whose role was to defend religious freedom, I became very disturbed learning how religion in Guantanamo was being used as a weapon. Yes, religion was being used as a weapon in Guantanamo. And because each and every one of the prisoners in Guantanamo is a Muslim, it was the use of Islam, the Muslim faith, as a weapon against these Muslim prisoners. And I want to share with you a little bit about how that was being done, how these individuals in Guantanamo were being persecuted for their faith, for believing in one God, for believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the ways in which this was being done is something the world learned about in 2005, first from a Newsweek magazine article, which reported that the Holy Quran down in Guantanamo Bay was being desecrated by U.S. personnel. as the Muslim chaplain who was down in Guantanamo Bay in late 2002 and most of 2003, I will confirm that the Holy Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, azza wa jal, was disrespected and desecrated by US personnel. Guards, when they searched the cells of the prisoners, and in any prison operation, of course, there's a need for security operations. But when prisoners searched the cells, they searched the belongings, the items, and when they came to the Holy Quran, they would turn it upside down and violently shake it, thinking that something dangerous might fall out. But instead, it was the bindings of the Mus'haf, of the Quran itself, that were torn, that were cracked, that were ripped, along with many of the pages. And when guards finished searching through the Quran, they recklessly tossed the Quran onto the floor. Because the prisoners were being held in these open-air cell-like cages, they could observe how the guards were conducting the search and how they were disrespecting the words of Allah. And the prisoners became angry. They became furious. And they began to protest. They banged on their steel beds. They banged on their steel doors in protest of how the Holy Quran was being disrespected. Their protests then turned to hunger strikes and even suicide attempts. Some of the Muslim prisoners in Guantanamo tried to hang themselves in their cell in protest of how the Holy Quran was being disrespected. Those more extreme measures of protest occurred when it was learned by prisoners that the Qurans were being taken into the interrogation room. And as a Muslim prisoner sat shackled in his chair at the wrist, waist, and ankles, an interrogator would take the Quran and slam it in front of him on the floor, stamp on it, kick it, even sit on it. Later, there were investigations that were carried out into abuses towards the Holy Quran, conducted by the US military itself. And they revealed that even the Holy Quran was at times urinated on by US personnel. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. But the prisoners protested, and it became chaotic inside the prison cell blocks for the guards, for the intelligence interrogators, for everyone. It wasn't long before personnel in Guantanamo leadership even came to me, the chaplain, the Muslim chaplain in Guantanamo, to try and help solve this problem which the US military themselves caused by desecrating the Quran. But that was one way in which religion was being used as a weapon. Personnel in Guantanamo recognized that we as Muslims, we revere the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We put the Quran on the highest shelf in our home. We never place the Quran somewhere that's filthy or dirty. We never put the Quran under our chair because we would never sit over the Quran. US personnel recognized how we as Muslims treat the Quran and respect it and tried to use that, to exploit that respect for the words of Allah to try and break the prisoner. That was just one example of how religion was being used as a weapon in Guantanamo Bay. Let me explain to you another way in which religion was being used as a weapon against these prisoners. In the interrogation operation, there were both male and female interrogators, and the interrogation operation was very competitive. The US Secretary of Defense was putting enormous amount of pressure on intelligence gathering in Guantanamo Bay to get information from these, quote, suspected terrorists. So it was very competitive. But the women in Guantanamo, the female interrogators, they felt that maybe they had an advantage over their male counterparts. And what was that advantage? Their gender, their sexuality. Some of those female interrogators were very ready to go into an interrogation room where that Muslim male prisoner sat shackled. And she would strip off her own clothes, stand naked in front of a Muslim prisoner, knowing that perhaps that prisoner came from a conservative Muslim society where men and women perhaps don't even shake hands. US personnel understood the culture of Islam The separation that we find even in this room where we have the men sitting in one section and the women in another. U.S. personnel would exploit this part of Muslim culture in order to try and break the prisoners down. Again, investigations were later conducted into abuses of prisoners in Guantanamo, and they reveal how some of these women interrogators inappropriately rubbed their own bodies on these Muslim prisoners as they couldn't resist being shackled in their chairs. Some of them even went so far as grabbing the genitals of male prisoners in Guantanamo while they were being interrogated. Again, here, religion is being used as a weapon, something that disturbed me to the core of my soul and bone. Let me explain to you in detail a third way in which religion was being used as a weapon in Guantanamo. One of the prisoners would describe for me an interrogation room. As a chaplain, I was assigned to the detention operation, far removed from the intelligence gathering operation. It would be unethical for a chaplain of any faith, of any religion, of any denomination, to assist interrogators in gaining information or intelligence from prisoners that were being held. So I was assigned to the guard force. But one of the prisoners, in my interaction with him, would describe for me this interrogation room. He said that in this interrogation room, there was a large circle that was on the ground, marked on the ground, a large circle. And inside this circle was another symbol. It was a symbol that represented Shaitan, Satan. And the interrogators would take the Muslim prisoner shackled, force him in the center of this satanic circle, and attempt to force that Muslim prisoner to bow down and prostrate, to make sujood, to make ruku' in the center of this satanic circle, while that interrogator screamed at this Muslim that Satan is your God now, not Allah. They were attacking these Muslims because they believed in Allah and they understood in Guantanamo the core belief of our faith, that we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we believe in the oneness, the uniqueness of Allah azza wa jal. And they persecuted these Muslims in Guantanamo for belief in Tawheed. This is how religion was being used as a weapon. But along with that, there were many other ways in which religion was used to exploit the situation in Guantanamo. There were times when Muslims in Guantanamo had their beards forcefully shaven as punishment. There were times when guards would intentionally turn the water off before the prayer time, before Salah, so prisoners couldn't make wudu or perform wudu and pray before and wash before prayer. There were times when interrogation sessions lasted so long that Muslim prisoners shackled in chains could not make their Salah. There were times when interrogators dressed themselves up as Catholic priests and would conduct a mock baptism of a Muslim prisoner, telling that prisoner that he was now baptized in the faith of Christianity and was no longer a Muslim. This is religious persecution, something which goes against the fundamental values of human rights, something which goes against even the Constitution of the United States, something which goes against our belief in Islam, which upholds justice and protects human rights. I was disturbed by these many, many things that was going on. I was disturbed how prisoners were being held in cage-like cells, being treated more like animals. I was disturbed even by the ages of some of the prisoners in Guantanamo, especially those who I came across that were as young as 12 years old. There were 12-year-old boys in Guantanamo being held by the U.S. military and were being characterized as suspected terrorists. I would raise concerns about these issues, bring forth the complaints of the prisoners, to the chain of command, to the higher levels of leadership, knowing the words of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who said that if someone sees an evil, he should change it with his hand. And if he can't change it with his hand, then he should change it with his tongue. That means speak out against these injustices. As a chaplain, it was my duty, it was my obligation to raise issue, to raise concern about abuse of prisoners in Guantanamo Bay. It was my obligation as a Muslim. It was my obligation as a U.S. citizen to raise concerns about abuses that were taking place in Guantanamo Bay. At first, I actually believed that when I brought forth much of this information, it was being valued by my superiors, my supervisors. They gave me awards down in Guantanamo, signed by the commanding general. I received a stellar officer evaluation report, the best that I had ever received in my 14 years as an officer in the United States Army. I felt that my input was being recognized, was being valued by the chain of command in Guantanamo. Because then I would receive what's known as R&R. R&R in the military means rest and relaxation. It means that you can send home for 2 weeks to visit your family and see them, but then you have to return to your military mission. I got R&R, and I got on a plane from Guantanamo Bay, which would land in Jacksonville, Florida. I had another flight to catch from Jacksonville, Florida to Seattle, Washington, where I would meet my wife and daughter, who I hadn't seen for 10 months, at least. But I never made that second flight from Florida to Seattle, Washington. Because when the plane landed from Guantanamo into Florida State at the Jacksonville Naval Air Station, I was met by people, customs and immigration officials, who would want to search my bags and backpack. And then they would make claims that I was carrying what they called suspicious documents. And then all of a sudden, there were intelligence officers, Army counterintelligence, Naval criminal investigators, the FBI was there. And they would say that I was carrying classified documents, and they got an arrest warrant. And they arrested me in secret. Nobody knew I had gotten arrested. I never made that flight to get back home. My wife and daughter had no idea what happened. I never showed up. My wife was worried. She would call my parents in New Jersey, asking to see if they had heard from me. My parents didn't hear anything. Nobody knew where I was. It was like I had disappeared in America. But I was sitting in prison. I was sitting in a maximum security prison on lockdown, and I was being accused by my own government of spying, espionage, aiding the enemy, aiding the terrorist enemy. And I was even threatened with the death penalty. I was held in jail, initially incommunicado, which means I wasn't allowed to contact anyone, so nobody knew where I was. But my family learned of where I was about 10 days later when they saw me on the news, on television, when the news of the day in September of 2003 was that the U.S. Army Muslim chaplain, Captain Yee, had been arrested and was being accused of these heinous crimes. Yes, I was sitting in this maximum security prison. And when they transferred me from Jacksonville, Florida, to South Carolina in this military naval brig, they threw me in the back of this truck next to an armed guard. Two of the armed guards in the front, the armed guard next to me, would take out of his bag these goggles, blackened out plastic goggles, and he put them over my eyes so I couldn't see anything. He took out of his bag these ear devices that go over the ears so I couldn't hear anything. I was shackled at the wrists and at the waist, at the ankles, just like prisoners in Guantanamo are shackled. I was being subjected to something which is known as sensory deprivation. Sensory deprivation. I was subjected to this very same technique that was being used on prisoners in Guantanamo Bay. Something which I observed from being down in Guantanamo as the Muslim chaplain. And I feared that my own government would strip from me all of my rights, all of my civil liberties, all of my human rights, as I understood that the Bush administration had declared that Geneva Conventions did not apply down in Guantanamo, and that prisoners in Guantanamo didn't have rights. I feared that my own government would strip from me, even as a U.S. citizen, my own rights. I was thrown in that prison for 76 days. After 76 days, and being accused of these awful crimes, being threatened with the death penalty, I was suddenly released. But the U.S. military still tried to put me in prison for lesser offenses. They wanted to charge me with what they called mishandling classified information. But that would mean they would have to show that I was carrying some classified information. But indeed, the facts were was that I had nothing. And all charges, all accusations against me were dropped, and I was released, sent back to duty, reinstated as a Muslim chaplain to serve the U.S. military. After I was cleared, I took it upon myself to tender my resignation, to resign from the U.S. Army and leave. And in January of 2005, I received an honorable discharge in addition to a second U.S. Army Commendation Medal for exceptionally meritorious service. I was given praise and recognition when I left the military after having been accused of being a traitor to my own country. Many people have asked me, why did this happen to me? Why do I believe this happened to me? And I believe it happened for at least three reasons. One is that I am a Muslim. After 9/11, after September 11th, where in the United States we find that many Muslims have been swept up and wrongfully accused, thrown in prison. It made it very easy for people to target me because I was Muslim. When people in Guantanamo saw me down at this prison camp, praying, bowing, and prostrating, they recognized that this was the way the Muslim prisoners prayed. When they saw me read the Holy Quran in the classical Arabic language, they recognized that this was how the prisoners prayed and read the Holy Quran. And to some few in Guantanamo, whether it was due to their ignorance or lack of knowledge, or even if it was due to their bigotry and hatred for Islam, it meant that I too was the enemy, and they would come and target me. But I also believed that it happened in part because of my ethnicity, being Chinese. But it also happened because, without a doubt, I was raising concerns. I was objecting to the torture down in Guantanamo, to the abuse of the prisoners being held in Guantanamo, to the conditions, the animal-like conditions down in Guantanamo. I raised concerns at a time when much of the world knew nothing about what was going on inside this prison camp. Today, of course, much of what I talk about is public information. We know that these abuses have occurred down in Guantanamo. We know they are facts now. But at a time when this information was not out, people were scared that I would expose the transgressions that were happening in this place called Guantanamo Bay. My brothers and sisters in Islam, it was a harrowing time for me to be in prison and to be treated like a traitor to my own country. It was a harrowing time in Guantanamo to see how religion was being used as a weapon and how individuals in Guantanamo were being persecuted for their Muslim faith. But that's my story. That's my experience as an American citizen who converted to Islam and became a Muslim chaplain and served at this now notorious prison camp. I hope that I've shed some light, that I've given you information which causes you to rise up and to stand firmly for justice, to stand up for human rights. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, "Kunu qawamina bilqist, shuhada'a lillah," that all you who believe, stand firmly for justice as a witness before Allah. And as Muslims, we have to speak out against wrongdoing. We have to speak out against human rights abuses. And even for me as a Muslim, an American citizen, it meant speaking out against my own government. My brothers and sisters in Islam, my name is Brother James Yusuf Yee. I'm the former U.S. Army Muslim chaplain who served in Guantanamo Bay. And as I said when I started my talk, that I'm inspired when people come to listen to my story, because I hope that it will cause those people to become stronger in their faith and stand up for human rights and justice. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, as I said when I started my talk, I'm inspired when people come to hear my story, because it's my hope that all of those who hear it, will they themselves become stronger in their faith, to become better people, to become individuals who will also ultimately stand up for human rights and justice. My brothers and sisters in Islam, much of what I've told you today is something that I've documented in a book that I had published in 2005, entitled For God and Country. For God and Country. Faith and Patriotism Under Fire. And it chronicles my journey to Islam, how I became Muslim, and then how, as a Muslim, I grew to want to serve Muslims who were serving in the armed forces, and how that path led me to Guantanamo Bay, ultimately to object to the horrors that you heard in my story today. My friends, my brothers, my sisters in Islam, it's an ultimate pleasure and honor to be here today, to be a part of this conference entitled Peace, the Solution for Humanity. Because without a doubt, our world needs peace. And it needs to be one that doesn't tolerate injustice and human rights. Jazakumullah khair. I'm your brother in Islam, Akhukum fillah, James Yusuf Yee. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, Brother James Yusuf Yee, for your spine-chilling and first-hand account of abuses at Guantanamo Bay. This by a decorated American Army officer and an upright Muslim certainly is a great contribution towards promoting peace, not only in the United States, but worldwide. Alhamdulillah. Now we have the open question and answer session in which the audience gets an opportunity to ask questions on the topic, but you are requested to be brief and to the point when you put forward your question, and you may ask only one question at a time. May I request the volunteers to kindly ensure that if there are any press personnel or journalists, kindly give them the first preference. Then, if there are any non-Muslims, to give them preference. And lastly, Muslim brothers, so that we have a more interesting session in the limited time available. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My name is Dr. Nadeem. I work in Saudi Arabia. First of all, I'm extremely sorry to hear about your harrowing experience, Brother James. My question to you is there something called as Geneva Convention? And is it not the right time to apply against the US Army and intelligence?
Yes, the Geneva Conventions is actually the international body of law which governs armed conflict. However, when the United States started putting prisoners in Guantanamo Bay, the interpretation of the law by the former Bush administration was that Geneva Conventions did not apply. And essentially that said that prisoners in Guantanamo didn't have rights. This was something that actually upset nations all over the world. Even nations that were close allies of the United States were disturbed when the United States claimed that Geneva Conventions wouldn't apply down in Guantanamo. When Barack Obama ran for president in 2008, one of the things that he promised was to restore Geneva Conventions, was to shut down Guantanamo Bay, was to ban torture without exception. For that reason, he had a lot of support from many of the communities of conscience within the United States. And we saw that when he was elected, that within 2 days he signed an executive order to close down Guantanamo within a year. That year would be January 22nd, 2010, and that date is closely coming. But Guantanamo Bay is still open today. There are still about 250 Muslims still being held in Guantanamo Bay, and President Barack Obama has not fulfilled that promise. If you are following the news, the issue of Guantanamo Bay, he is struggling to get this place closed down, as many conservative Republican right-wing lawmakers are objecting to the closing of Guantanamo. But yes, Geneva Conventions is important because it guarantees rights to those who are imprisoned, among many other things.
Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, brother Yusuf.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My name is Asher Khan. I'm from travel and tourism industry. My question is, we all believe that the human rights were detained in Guantanamo Bay, but putting more light on the atrocities done with the holy book Quran, don't you think it would instigate more people to do injustice or any harm to again doing some terrorist attacks?
Great question, and I thank you for that. But without a doubt, not only the abuse and the desecration of the Quran, in my view, is considered something which would motivate others to retaliate or to take revenge, but in general, the whole concept of Guantanamo Bay and holding prisoners there, abusing them, torturing them, and holding them indefinitely without charge is something that I feel pushes people to the extreme. One of the arguments against Guantanamo is that if you didn't hate America before you were put in Guantanamo, you certainly hate America now. And in my interactions with those prisoners in Guantanamo, I didn't meet a single individual who had anger towards the U.S. government and military for wrongly imprisoning the vast, vast majority who are there. So sure, one of the arguments against Guantanamo is that it helps recruit people to extremist ideologies.
Thank you.
Yes, sister.
Myself, Dr. Sunita Magre. I am the reader in the Department of Education, University of Mumbai. I want to ask one question, that what is the program on peace education exposing the U.S. government?
Can you repeat your question slowly and speak into the mic, not on the side?
Actually, the sister is more comfortable with Hindi. Inshallah, I'll translate her question. She wants to know what is the program or what action are people worldwide taking to expose the reality of the U.S. state government when it comes to the exploitation of the prisoners in the Guantanamo Bay?
From what I know and from my knowledge, it's mostly the human rights organizations that are leading this effort to raise awareness and to expose much of the injustices that have occurred not only in Guantanamo, but in other places like Abu Ghraib in Iraq, in Kandahar, in Bagram, and in other secret CIA black sites, which we don't know their precise locations. From what I know, it's mostly the human rights organizations like Amnesty International, Human Rights First, the Center for Constitutional Rights, other organizations like in the UK, Cage Prisoners, Reprieve, and whatnot, who are leading the effort to raise awareness. But what I've observed in the United States is that many people in my own country stay blind to what's going on outside the borders of the United States. Many polls have been taken over and over again, and they reveal that most people in the United States are not very concerned about international affairs. And I believe this is something that has to change. When I lectured in the UK to students at universities throughout Britain, I saw a vast difference with regard to the interest that students had for world affairs. This is an area in which the American people really have to improve upon.
Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Jai Kishore Sharma, student of BLLB Honours, studying at present in Bengal Law College, situated in Shantiniketan, West Bengal. Sir, my question is regarding the definition of justice. I have asked many teachers, what is the exact definition of justice? We have learned constitutions, even though the concise definition of justice is not given. Sir, I want to ask you, in the Quran, there is any definite or perfect definition of justice is there?
The question is, what's the precise definition of justice? And I would agree with you that perhaps from nation to nation, constitution to constitution, legal document to legal document, there may be some variations. Is there a precise definition in the Quran? I myself am not a Muslim scholar, and I would encourage you to pose that question to some of the ulama, the more learned, as to how Islam defines that word justice. But we know that the word justice is found throughout the Quran, and we know that the Prophet, peace be upon him, used the word several times, whether it's the word adl or whether it's qist. So with regard to the precise definition of justice, I would refer that question to, again, the scholars.
The next question from the brother in the rear.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My name is Talat Ansari. I'm from Nagpur. Thanks for the light shown on the prisoners. May Allah guide us in the right way. And we'll be highly obliged if you can throw the lights of those prisoners where they produced ever in front of the court, where they just accused or they were proven criminals. They were free to speak in front of judges.
Yeah. The situation of prisoners in Guantanamo today is that most are being held indefinitely without charge, without evidence. Is that your question?
Yeah, I doubt it.
As I mentioned, when I was there, the numbers were up towards 660. And I believe there have been approximately 700 to 800 individuals who have been held in Guantanamo. Over 500 have already been released, never to have been charged with the crime, leaving about 250 or so still remaining. Of those 215 still remaining, very few have had any charges actually brought against them. I myself also am waiting for the Obama administration to release those who are not going to be charged with crime, and for those who may be charged with a crime, to put them on trial in a fair and just court. I think one of the problems that is already recognized is that some of those who the U.S. government firmly believe may be criminal terrorists were kept before Guantanamo in secret CIA black sites where they were tortured beyond our imaginations. We know that some of these individuals were waterboarded, subjected to waterboarding, water torture, where they have water poured over their face and you get the feeling that you're suffocating through water and drowning. We know that individuals have gone through that torture like 183 times within 1 month. So the problem is some of these prisoners who the U.S. government may want to try in a court have been tortured so bad that perhaps any evidence that they may have gotten from these individuals could never be used in court. So it's a huge, complicated issue, Guantanamo Bay, and how it's going to be legally handled. I am of the opinion that if a person is not going to be tried in a court of law and can't be tried, then he should be released.
Yes, sister.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Tanzeel Alapur and I'm a student of grade 11. My question is, what America did to Iraq and Afghanistan is now trying to do the same thing to Iran. And UN is in the puppet hands of Israel and US. As Muslims, what do we do apart from raising awareness? Because we Muslims are not at all going to get justice. And without justice, there will be no peace in this world.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yes, indeed, there cannot be peace without justice. And until our community, ourselves, our Muslims, put forth every effort that we can to organize, to plan, to sacrifice our wealth and our time and effort towards these causes, we will never be able to accomplish those goals like other sectors of societies or other groups have. We have to make a commitment individually, not only to learn our faith, but to sacrifice our time and wealth towards these things. One of the things that I see our community needs to do, Muslims, is to really understand systems, how the political systems work, how to affect change, the role that money plays in political systems, like in the United States. And in order for us to have the same influence as other groups on elected officials, that means we have to be investing our money and our time and our efforts towards those same causes. We haven't done that. In the United States, for example, we are at infant stages with regard to our participation in the political process. And as a result, other groups, whether they be religious or ethnic, are far, far ahead of Muslims with regard to getting their voices heard by elected officials and getting their concerns met by those people who are elected to office.
Yes, brother.
My name is Manish Katira. We are into NGO, Child's Right and Family Welfare. I just wanted to ask, there is one IPC law, 498A. It's been very much misused by the woman toward husband and father and mother. I just wanted to say that this law has been very much misused, and as a human right, it's very much violation about the father and mother. Without an interrogation to the police take father and mother behind bars unnecessarily, without interrogation.
He's talking about abuse by women who are given more rights than men in this particular law.
Yeah, I mean, in general, we know what Allah says in the Quran, وَأَقْسِتُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. It commands us to do justice and stand for justice because Allah loves those who are just. So in any situation, we as Muslims have to demand that there is fairness, whether it's for women or whether it's for men.
Sir, there is no law for men.
Yes.
There is a law for women, there is a law for animals, but there is no law for men.
There are many men being abused by their wives.
Yeah, that's true, sir.
So that's the issue. Again, in general, it's understanding the legislative system of your nation, of your country. There's no law for men. And if that's something you want, you have to understand fully how laws are passed so that you can get the support to get a law passed that protects rights of men. One of the issues that I said earlier was, what we don't do well as a community is understand systems and get involved and participate. Because this seems like, from your perspective, this is an issue that is not being met. It's not being addressed. And so what I would encourage you to do is to get that support and understand how you might get elected officials to legislate something that would protect the rights of men.
Thank you, sir.
Jazakallah. Yes, sister.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Alia Mukadam, and my question to you is, being locked up in maximum security prison with such accusations, how traumatizing was it for you? And after you were released, how did you get over it? Has it made you stronger morally?
Jazakallah khair. Great question. I was locked up for 76 days. But one of the things I will say is that my faith in Islam and my faith in Allah never was shaken. Alhamdulillah. And my faith perhaps grew stronger. And I often talk about this in other presentations and in other settings, especially when I visit Muslim communities in my own country and talk about faith during a time of crisis. And this is something which I will talk about later this week. But being locked away in that time, there was nothing I could do. What could I do in that situation? I had no control over what was happening to me. And the only way to come to grips with the accusations that were being levied against me and with the threat of the death penalty was recognizing that Allah has control over all things, and that my reliance on Allah was the only thing that gave me a stable mental state of mind in that situation. Sure, the experience was traumatizing. And in some way, I can say that I experienced what's known as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, right? Whenever someone is exposed to a traumatizing experience, will be affected in some way, whether their sleep pattern is altered or whether someone suffers through depression or whatnot. But the experience was also very traumatizing for my family. Disappearing, my wife perhaps, was maybe even more traumatized than me, although it was me who was sitting in that solitary confinement, okay? So yes, it had a drastic effect on everyone in my own family. How do I deal with it now? Speaking out, of course, is part of the therapy that I go through, to be able to talk about my experience. And one of the things that I mentioned about in documenting my story is referencing something known as emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence. And what is that? That's taking all of that energy that comes from your emotions, whether it's fear, uncertainty, nervousness, and anger, and directing that energy towards something that is positive and constructive. Okay. So when I went through that whole situation, those emotions were there. Uncertainty. Didn't know what was going to happen to me. Fear. They may put me to death. Anger. They shouldn't be doing this to me. I'm a U.S. citizen. Right? And taking that energy and focusing it and directing it towards something that's positive. And in that solitary state, how did I do that? Submerging myself in dhikr, remembering Allah, reading the Quran. I was allowed one book, and that was an Arabic English translation of the Quran, Yusuf Ali, right? So read the Quran, make dhikr, recite the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say walhamdulillah, subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, over and over and over, and get closer to the one who created me. That was how I was able to essentially stay positive during that time.
Jazakallah.
Wa iyyakum.
Jazakallah, Brother James Yusuf Yee, for your valuable contribution in a first-hand understanding and account of what's going on in Guantanamo Bay.
Assalamu alaikum.